Well, welcome to all of you who are joining us for this reception here at the State Department in the Ben Franklin Room. And it is a particular honor for us to welcome not only a great leader, but someone who has a strong personal commitment to the U.S.-India relationship, President Barack Obama. Mr. President, we've worked hard today, and we've actually been working hard ever since this strategic dialogue was agreed to between you and Prime Minister Singh. Many of the people you see before you are the people who are actually doing the work that make Minister Krishnan and I look like we're fulfilling our responsibilities. But we so value this relationship. And I came across a quote which I think summarizes what we feel. Mark Twain once wrote, "India is the cradle of the human race, the birthplace of human speech, the mother of history, the grandmother of legend, and the great-grandmother of tradition." And I love the fact that it's mothers that... Well, given the talent, the expertise, and the enthusiasm in this room, not only from our distinguished delegation from India and all of the people here in our government who have worked so hard, but Indian Americans who themselves embody the importance of this relationship, we are so excited as we broaden and deepen this extraordinary partnership. And now the real work begins. We're turning our ideas and our aspirations into actions and results and working to unleash the tremendous potential that exists for even greater opportunity, prosperity, and peace for the people of India and of the United States and of the world. Let me now introduce Minister Krishna, who has been a wonderful colleague, and ever since we announced this strategic dialogue during my visit last year, has been so supportive and enlisted the commitment of so many of the distinguished ministers and officials from the government of India. Please join me in welcoming Minister Krishna.
Mr. President, last year, you and Prime Minister Manmohan Singh launched a new phase in the India-US global strategic partnership. I bring to you from Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh, who spoke with you last week. He has asked me to reiterate the importance he attaches to this strategic dialogue and his personal commitment to it as an instrument for strengthening our bilateral cooperation. He recalls very warmly his meeting with you at the successful Nuclear Security Summit in April 2010. He and over 1 billion citizens of India look forward to welcoming you and your family later this year. I am grateful for the warmth and gracious hospitality that has been extended by Secretary Clinton to me and to my colleagues and officers. Her commitment and involvement in working for a positive transformation of India-US relations has been a key factor in the achievement of the global strategic partnership that we have established today. Mr. President, we consider our mutually beneficial relationship with the United States to be one of our foremost foreign policy priorities. There are few relationships in the world that have so much potential as India-US relations, because I believe that our cooperation is not only for mutual benefit, but is destined to have a strong impact on global peace, prosperity, and stability in the 21st century. Mr. President, as India regains the momentum of our economic growth, new opportunities are emerging to empower rural communities, especially women. Time and again, we have seen in other developing countries, for example, in the pioneering efforts of Anne Siatoro, your late mother. Mr. President, in Indonesia, the transformational impact of innovation and microfinance, that is our hope for transforming our economy and society in an equitable, inclusive, and sustainable manner. My colleagues and I have had very productive meetings yesterday and today in our strategic dialogue. We reviewed progress in all areas of our ongoing cooperation and also focused on our vision and the roadmap for the future. We also discussed how we would work together to realize the immense potential of our cooperation across the spectrum of human endeavor, from strategic cooperation to sustainable growth and economic and developmental partnerships to achieve real benefits for our peoples and for the world. Mr. President, we are pleased that you, with your deep personal links with the Asia-Pacific region, are taking strong interest in the future of this rapidly evolving region. We look forward to a stable, secure, prosperous future for this region, defined by cooperation, openness, and inclusion. A peaceful and stable South Asia is critical for our development and security. We believe that India can be a dependable anchor of the region's growth. We are supporting economic development and increasing trade and investment in several of our neighboring countries. We remain committed to Afghanistan's development and supporting the Afghan people in their efforts to build their capacity and assume the rightful responsibilities for governance, security, and development. With international support, they will succeed in their efforts. The United States have made great sacrifices in Afghanistan and invested in heavily in Afghanistan and Pakistan. These are no ordinary commitments for the American people as they promote the cause of peace and resist the evils of terrorism. My Prime Minister has consistently believed in the need for dialogue to seek a future of peace and cooperation with Pakistan. I will meet the Foreign Minister of Pakistan in Islamabad in the month of July. The trust deficit in relations between India and Pakistan needs to be specifically addressed. The continuing threat of terrorism is a cause of great concern for us in India. Mr. President, our agenda is rich and extensive. I thank you once again for your belief in and commitment to this relationship, and look forward to your visit to India, where a very warm and heartfelt welcome awaits you and the family. Thank you so much, Mr. President.
Well, Mr. President, we love having you come to the State Department and to have this chance to see all of these people who have worked so hard on this dialogue is for us a very great honor. And we thank you for your personal commitment, as Minister Krishna outlined, to broadening and deepening this critical relationship between India and the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the President of the United States.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. Namaste. I want to thank Secretary Clinton for your outstanding leadership, and I want to thank Minister Krishna for both the kind words and the incredible work that you've put in to trying to strengthen even more and deepen even more the relationship between the two largest democracies in the world. Secretary Clinton, I think, as you may be aware, is a great admirer of India, and I know the sentiment is shared in return. In fact, I'm told that one of the Secretary's favorite restaurants in Delhi added a new item to the menu, the Hillary platter. This is true. What does it have? Chapati?
Oh, it's got all kinds of things.
I will try that. Now, it's been said, and Hillary alluded to this, that there are two kinds of people in the world, those who do the work and those who take the credit. There's a corollary to this saying, try to be in the first group because there's much less competition. It's a lot less crowded. Well, Prime Minister Singh and I are very proud to take credit for our two nations forging an unprecedented partnership through this strategic dialogue. But tonight I wanted to come by and express my gratitude to all of you, not only Secretary Clinton and Minister Krishna, but also everybody in attendance who are actually doing the hard work of advancing the goals that Prime Minister Singh and I set forward in our bilateral meetings. I want to not only thank Minister Rao, Minister Krishna, but I also want to thank Secretary Rao and members of the Indian delegation, our two wonderful ambassadors, Meera Shankar, where'd she go? There she is, as well as my great friend Tim Romer, and leaders from across my administration. And I want to thank everybody who's here from India and the United States who works every day to bring our countries even closer together, leaders in business, in civil society, academia, faith groups, especially our many friends from our very strong, very proud, very vibrant Indian American community. I was just telling Minister Krishna that right before I came here, I was congratulating the National Spelling Bee champion, who was a young Indian American young lady, and her parents could not have been prouder. And it just was a wonderful reminder of how strong the bonds between our two countries are. Michelle and I were honored to welcome Prime Minister Singh and Mrs. Kaur to the White House for the very first official state visit of my presidency. It was a state visit that demonstrated that our relations with India are at the highest of priorities for my administration and for me personally as President of the United States. I said then that India is a leader in Asia and around the world. It's a rising power and a responsible global power. That's why I firmly believe that the relationship between the United States and India will be a defining partnership in the 21st century. The new national security strategy that I released last week makes this absolutely clear. A fundamental pillar of America's comprehensive engagement with the world involves deepening our cooperation with 21st century centers of influence, and that includes India. Moreover, the relationship between the United States and India is fundamentally unique because, as our strategy explains, we share common interests, but we also share common values. As the world's two largest democracies and as countries that are rich in diversity, with deep and close connections among our people. In other words, the United States values our partnership not because of where India is on a map, but because of what we share and where we can go together. India is indispensable to the future that we seek, a future of security and prosperity for all nations. That's why a third of my cabinet has already visited India, not only for the chapatis, that is why officials from across my administration are part of this strategic dialogue. That's why I want to thank you for the progress that we've made together since Prime Minister Singh's visit. We're deepening our economic cooperation on finance and investment and the trade that creates jobs in both of our countries. And I look forward to working with Prime Minister Singh and our fellow G20 partners this month in Toronto as we work to foster economic growth that is both balanced and sustained. With our agreement on fuel reprocessing, we're moving ahead with our civil nuclear agreement. We're expanding our green partnership to promote green buildings, energy efficiency, and the sustainable development that creates jobs and reduces poverty. And as we strive to implement our Copenhagen commitments, we'll be working together to ensure a successful climate conference in Mexico later this year. We're cooperating more closely than ever before against transnational threats. This includes, as Minister Krishna alluded to, making progress for the Afghan people and preventing terrorism, whether it's in Manhattan or in Mumbai. It includes securing vulnerable nuclear materials, a goal we advanced at our Nuclear Security Summit, where I thanked Prime Minister Singh for committing India to building a new center of excellence for nuclear energy and security. And our efforts include a stronger global nonproliferation regime where all nations live up to their obligations. We're broadening partnerships between our people, especially in science, technology, and global health. More students are taking advantage of our expanded Fulbright Nehru program. We're working to expand ties between our universities and community colleges, and we're partnering on agriculture and research to reduce global hunger and to share India's incredible progress with other countries. Finally, as global partners, we're going to sustain this momentum at the highest levels. During his state visit, the Prime Minister graciously invited me and my family to visit India this year, and I happily accepted. And as I confirmed to him when we spoke last week, I'm delighted to announce tonight that I plan to visit India in early November. So, I look forward to advancing our partnership, to experiencing all that India and its people and its incredible ancient culture have to offer, and I intend to create an Obama platter. Yes. As I look ahead to my visit, I've got another quote that matches up pretty well with Mark Twain's. This is a scholar from Europe who traveled to India more than a century ago. And he said, "Whatever sphere of the human mind you may select for your special study, whether it be language or religion or mythology or philosophy, whether it be law or customs, primitive art or science, you have to go to India." Because, he said, some of the most valuable and instructive material of the history of man are treasured up in India and India only. So when it comes to the sphere of our work, building a future of greater prosperity, opportunity, and security for our people, there is no doubt I have to go to India. But even more, I am proud to go to India, and I look forward to the history that we will make together, progress that will be treasured not just by this generation, but by generations to come. Thank you very much, everybody.